Hi, my name is Matthew Hickox, and I am a consultant to the Federal Highway Administration on transportation hydraulics. I have over 12 years of experience on transportation hydraulics projects, including site assessments and problem solving. I also teach courses for the National Highway Institute. Today we're going to talk about one of the more interesting and challenging aspects of hydraulic engineering, when you need to weigh in on a maintenance or damage issue. We're out here at an example site, but before we talk about this particular site, let's back up in this process to when you first hear about the issue. In this video, we will cover the three main steps of any maintenance or damage issue: pre-field office reconnaissance, field scoping, and post-field documentation. You'll want to go check out the problem in the field, but you should start your investigation before going into the field. That will help you make the most of your time in the field. The first step when a maintenance or damage issue arises is to determine the stakeholders and decision makers. Identifying who is affected by the maintenance or damage issue is important. This may be the initiator that reported the issue to you, and that could be maintenance staff, a local municipality, or even a landowner. Equally important is determining who are the agencies or entities authorized to make the final decisions to address the maintenance or damage issue. Determining the agency or entities authorized to make these decisions may not be immediately clear, so maintaining good communication with all parties throughout this process keeps all parties informed as the investigation progresses. Also, it is beneficial to determine if the issue may require permitting for a potential fix. This could include federal, state, or local permitting agencies, and those permits could include things like environmental or floodplain permits, just to name a few. Where is the site located? Use an online or other geographical information system or GIS mapping application to view the site from aerial imagery. This will help you orient yourself to the site and understand nearby land uses. Are maintenance records or as-built drawings and drainage reports available? As-built drawings and reports, if available, would be good to review to understand the intended design and function of the site. Maintenance reports and staff can be a good source of information about regular maintenance activities near the site. What is the approximate drainage basin at the problem site? Is it on-site highway drainage, a small cross drainage, or a larger river or floodplain? What is the approximate size of the drainage basin? What is the land use of the drainage basin? In some states, you can use the USGS StreamStats application to delineate watersheds. You'll need to verify basin size and characteristics with a field visit, as site conditions may have changed recently without notice to your agency or adjacent agencies or landowners. What is the FEMA regulatory floodplain status at the site? If the problem is in a stream or river that is part of a FEMA floodplain, any fixes to the problem will require a floodplain development permit from either FEMA or a state or local agency. The National Flood Hazard Layer Viewer can be a quick way to check if your site is in a FEMA floodplain. Even if the site is not in a FEMA floodplain, the authority having jurisdiction may still require floodplain permitting. There may be other permitting requirements at the maintenance or damage site. For example, environmental permitting may be required. Also, be sure to collaborate with your agency's permitting specialist about any potential repair. Now that you have reviewed the available data, it is time to go into the field. To help you get ready for a field visit, the FHWA has made another video for this series on the topic of data mining and pre-field preparation. Please refer to that video. Now, let's head back out to our example site where we have a 60-inch corrugated metal culvert with several issues under a state highway. I'll meet you out at the site.
Yeah, this culvert obviously has some issues with the inlet and debris, but before we get too much into this, I think we got somebody else joining us. Hey, I'm so glad you could join us out here in the field. I'm out here meeting with the initiator to start talking about this issue. Before we begin, we need to re-ask the initiator the questions of what type of problem is it, and how and when did the problem develop. You need to remember that this is a fact-finding mission. You need to remain unbiased throughout this process. You need to be sure and remind the initiator and the stakeholders of this expectation as you're out here in the field. Now, let's get to it and start to determine what kind of issues we have here. The first question we want to ask is, what type of problem is it? Drainage-related maintenance or damage issues can fall into several different categories. Out here at our example site, we have issues such as debris at the culvert entrance, corrosion of the culvert invert, vertical misalignment between the culvert and the stream bed, and embankment loss along the road shoulder. Other common types of problems can include frequent road overtopping during storm events. You can also have erosion or scour that happens in a ditch, at a culvert or a storm drain outfall location, at bridge piers or abutments, at utility crossings, and along roadway embankments. You may also see debris collection, and that can be debris or trash clogging inlets, debris blocking a culvert entrance, or debris on a bridge pier. Another type of problem is failure to drain properly, such as when a structure at a road crossing doesn't drain right, or an inlet at a low point along a gutter is clogged. Another type of problem can be flow draining or being diverted to an adjacent catchment, over the sag of the roadway when the sag is not located at the crossing location, or outside the right-of-way onto a landowner's property. Another type of problem is sedimentation. Sedimentation can reduce ditch flow capacity and can block culvert barrels and reduce bridge waterway capacity. Maintenance issues can also cause negative impacts on aquatic organism passage, or AOP. These issues may be region-dependent. Another region- and season-dependent type of problem is ice blockage. Another question we want to ask is, how and when did the problem develop? Drainage-related problems can happen over various periods of time. They can be event-driven, such as a flood event. They can happen gradually over long durations of time, such as aggradation or degradation in a roadside ditch or other channel. They can happen in the seasonal aspect, such as ice flows during the winter time that may clog up your culvert. You can also look at historical aerial imagery via some online GIS application to help you determine when a problem started occurring. In addition to talking with the initiator and stakeholders, what story does the landscape of the site tell you? Take photographs of the problem if it is currently visible, like an eroded embankment or corroded culvert invert. If not currently visible, take photographs of where the problem occurs, like a low point on the pavement or along the gutter where ponding occurs when it rains. Take notes of the person's description of the problem. Take measurements where relevant, such as the length of erosion along the roadway embankment, diameter of a culvert, and the depth of scour or degradation. If the issue can be measured in the field easily, note it. Take photographs of the areas upstream and downstream of the problem. Take notes on the conditions upstream and downstream, or up and downgrade if along a roadway. It is one thing to develop a fix of the obvious problem, for instance, to bring in fill to replace eroded soil, but that fix may not last unless you identify and address the root cause. One important question is the root of the problem on site, in other words, within highway right-of-way and caused by the highway facility, or is it off-site, in other words, caused by something upstream or downstream of the right-of-way and needing cooperation by other agencies or property owners? Use the local site knowledge of the initiator and stakeholders to help answer this question. One example of root causes could be scour at a culvert outlet. This could be strictly a local scour hole caused by excessive unmitigated outlet velocity from the culvert barrel. This is an on-site cause. Or it could be degradation that has worked its way up the channel from downstream or is caused by development further up in the watershed. This is an off-site cause. An energy dissipator
or riprap apron just downstream of the culvert will sustainably mitigate the problem in the first case, but would be an ineffective temporary fix in the second case. Another example could be sedimentation reducing ditch or culvert capacity. This could be a local problem of sediment being deposited at a specific location in the ditch or culvert due to an abrupt change in the slope or width. This is an on-site cause. Or it could be an excessive amount of sediment that is flowing into the ditch from upstream and outside of the right-of-way due to poor land use practices in construction, development, or agriculture, to name some possibilities.
Be sure to take some time with the initiator to brainstorm some potential fixes for the site. You'll want to be sure and remember to consider public safety in any of the fixes that you consider. Some of these fixes could include just a simple fix. Will a simple fix address your issue? Do think about it, though, in terms of, will a simple fix address the root cause? If a simple fix does not address the root cause, then you'll have to come back out again at some point in the future. That may lead you to determine that a simple fix now to address a public safety issue and a long-term fix that requires more design may be beneficial. Also take some time to consider things such as site access, traffic, and other safety concerns for your potential fix. Before you adjourn the meeting, do take some time to thank the initiator and any other stakeholders that came out to meet with you for their time. Now, let's head back to the office to write our post-field memorandum.
Welcome back to the office. You can make the most out of the pre-field and field work that you've done so far by creating a deliverable right away about the problem that you have encountered. One state DOT uses a memo format called SBAR, which has the following section headings: situation, background, assessment, and recommendations. This DOT's format allows for a concise report of the problem, what your pre-field and field investigation has revealed, and what you recommend as next steps. You can use this type of memo or whatever format your agency is currently using. Be sure to use enough photos, measurements, and graphics to make your points clearly.
Remember, any drainage maintenance issue should include pre-field office reconnaissance, field scoping, and post-field documentation. Thank you for watching this video.